Hello, boys and girls, and welcome to another amazing episode of How to Market Your Co-Working Space the Simple Way.
This podcast is brought to you by Cowork.Tools, super simple onboarding for new members to your workspace. Cowork Tools sources out your GDPR, your AML, and your KYC. There's an even a collaborative payment platform. Of course, I know what all of that means. So stop messing around with your onboarding and get back to building your co-working community. Head to Cowork.Tools to get started. Bye!
And I'm very excited because today's guest is a lady called Sonia. And not only did we met in Copyblogger. I don't know if you remember that.
Yes.
And then a long time ago. And you live in Buenos Aires, which is my other favorite city. So in the universe, Sonia, what are you known for and what would you like to be known for?
In the universe, these days I'm known most for talking a lot about inclusive marketing, and it's right up my alley. And I think what I want to be known for, it's a direct line from inclusive marketing, is being an advocate for belonging, because both life and business is about belonging, and so much of being inclusive in your marketing is about creating an environment for the people that you want to serve to feel like they belong with you.
I have to pause for a minute because that was so beautiful. What is it? Because we were talking a bit before we came on air, and for a lot of people that spend time with us in co-working, you know, they'll know we're me and my co-working assembly folks are always attempting to champion inclusivity, can't even say it, uh-huh. and diversity in the way people communicate. And a big thing is like making sure that people know they're invited, not just, we have a thing where we say, you know, I told everyone it was on, but mm-hmm. did you invite them to become? And, yeah. Did you invite them to come? And there's a very subtle difference that doesn't, you know, the world operates very differently for, you know, white men as it does for everyone else. And that's, you know, can you say a bit about that? Because I think people are accidentally excluding people.
Yeah. And I think we should even take it a step further than inviting people to come, because it goes back to that whole sense of belonging. So for instance, there's this influencer that I follow. I'm on her email list, and she sent a couple of emails, maybe months back before the whole pandemic hit. She was going to a conference in California, and she's like, come to this conference. You know, you can come hang out with me, come hang out with these cool people, blah, 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 blah. But as I was looking at the pictures, she was definitely inviting the people in her audience to come. But as I looked at the pictures, I'm like, this isn't a place that I want to go. It doesn't look like there's nobody who looks like me there, or maybe there's one person. And I didn't feel like, from looking at the photos, I just didn't feel like it would be a place where I would feel like I belong. So it goes further. You do need to invite people, particularly people who have been underserved, who aren't represented, to make sure that they know that you want them there. However, you have to take it a step further to make sure that you create an environment that makes them feel like they belong, so that they'll not only want to come, but want to stay and want to stick around. So that's really the next step forward that we want people to take, is to make sure that you're creating that space. Inviting people is great. It's a great step in the right direction, but you got to take it a step further if you really want to move the needle.
And how do you do that on for this podcast? It's a co-working space website, mm-hmm. but a lot of co-working spaces are kind of like events as well. Mm-hmm. And how do you do that on a website without looking like you're ticking boxes? Because there's a subtle kind of art to not making it fake,
right,
but actually doing it properly.
So I think it starts with diversifying your circle of influence, because I think a lot of people, they want to make a quick fix in, okay, we're going to diversify our photos, so make them more representative. And yeah, that might be good because it showcases that you do want to, that you do value diversity to a certain extent, but it's a really, it's one step forward when you don't really have any other options, right? When you're just sort of getting started. the thing that you would do as you're starting to diversify your circle of influence is start surrounding your people with surrounding yourself with people who are different from you. Get to know them. And so get to know them on a different level, how they think, where they hang out. And then that will help you as you're building relationships with them, help you sort of get into their world a little bit, get into their culture, so that as you're starting to promote what it is that you're doing, because naturally they'll start to hang out with you more, you'll start to have opportunities potentially to collaborate, get them to be at your co-working space. So then whenever you do want to have photos, it's much more authentic, photos, videos, whatever it is, events, it's much more authentic because as a part of your normal way of operating, you have people who are different from you in your world. So it doesn't have to see, oh, mate, like as we're looking at all these photos, it's all white men or it's all one group of homogenous type of people. It's a much more authentic sort of organic way to start to reach out to people and get them to see that, yeah, this is an environment that I want to try out because it looks like I can fit in here. So just by working through starting to intentionally work on diversifying the circles that you find yourself in will help start to open the door for you to do that.
And other than being a nice human thing to do, mm-hmm. is there, what are the advantages of acting around your business like that?
And you grow it. You grow your business for sure. I'm sorry to cut you off. It is, being inclusive is the right thing to do, but it also helps you attract more customers because I think a lot of times businesses are sending signals to customers who have differences. So let's say right now we're talking about racial diversity as well as gender diversity. They're sending signals to people that you don't belong here. And you're sending those signals unintentionally to people who could be the perfect person for your co-working space, right? So if you start to be more inclusive in your approach and who you hang out with and who you're marketing to and who you're creating space for, then you'll start to attract the people that you're already attracting, the people who are already paying you, but then you'll start to attract and convert and earn the loyalty of those other people who you've been sending away and turning away by sending those you don't belong here signals by the way your marketing is set up. So think of it as closing a leaky bucket, and you're closing a leaky bucket that you probably didn't even know that you had.
And if you have a leaky bucket and you don't know you have it, how can you find out you have a leaky bucket? Because I was telling you before we came on that I just never noticed how many white men were in pictures of co-working mm-hmm. spaces 5 years ago.
Yeah.
And I thought I was well up on my diversity and inclusion, you know, I'm there. And then to my horror, I found out, and you know, the more I find out, the more I realize how much I need to know. I just didn't think it was an issue.
Yeah.
I was absolutely completely blind, and luckily I'm surrounded with people now that, you know, in family and friends and work colleagues who keenly point out my shortcomings, probably even in this podcast. How do you become self-aware?
You just start. You make the decision to, right? And then a way as a business owner, you can actually start to look at your numbers. Because I think a lot of times, none of us think that we are part of the problem, part of any type of problem. And especially as it relates to diversity and inclusion and belonging, most people think that they're in pretty good shape. But I've heard a lot of business owners of late, in particular as this whole reckoning has been happening in business over the past couple of months since the murder of George Floyd, when they started to look at their numbers, they started to recognize, oh, wow, I'm not as diverse as I think I am. I'm not quite as open as I think I am. And that's not just as relates to diversity, inclusion, and belonging. That happens in life, period. I was looking at the step counter on my phone recently, and I noticed that the last 3 months, the amount of steps that I had taken was like so much less than it had been like over the course of the last year. And I was like, what's going on? And then I was like, oh, you know, I had a baby. Oh, you know, we've been in quarantine here in Buenos Aires, so we can't go out and walk around and, you know, get places the way I used to. But the data made things very clear for me. And whereas you might have an idea, or you might, you know, have these blind spots where you're not really aware, because it's just a natural sort of thing to think that you're doing better than what you are. But the data will tell a different story. So you become self-aware simply by deciding to, and not being afraid to go and start looking at your numbers and sitting with what those numbers tell you. And then you can start to look and say, all right, what can I do to get my numbers to start looking the way I want them to? So you can do that by setting some type of representation goals that you want. So for instance, in your co-working space, you can say, I want the customers, the people who are part of this community, to be reflective of the different types of people who are in the community that where we live, where this co-working space exists. So if you set that type of goal and look at what are some of those demographic characteristics, compare that to what exists in your community now, and that'll give you a bit of a baseline and to help you guide you in terms of where you need to go. In terms of some very concrete metrics to help you, you know, put in some type of initiatives to help you get to that place.
So how do I start with that? Do I go to, like, you know, in our co-working space, and this is a hypothetical example, but like, you know, in our, the person's real, in our co-working space is Sangeeta. Do I go to Sangeeta and say, oh, hi Sangeeta, you know, I noticed you are a Southeast Asian female and we need to get more of you in here. How do I do that? Is that like a total, you know, foot in mouth move to do, or, you know, like where do you I think most people do know where to start, but like if you just don't know where to start, how do you do it?
So a lot of times people can start by, they can, a simple way is to do it visually, and visually is going to steer you wrong in some instances, but you can start there, and it's a very quick and dirty sort of way to evaluate. You can do it based upon gender and way people identify themselves. You can look at somebody, okay, you know, does this person look like they're Southeast Asian? Does this person look like they're Black? Does this person look like, you know, are they come from the US? They come from Europe? Like, you can start to do those things, back of the envelope type of things. If you want to start to get a little bit more sophisticated with it to help you get more accurate numbers based upon the way people identify themselves, you can do more surveys that allow people to give you that identifiable information. And you can start to track that over time. You can let people know that as they're giving that information, that you're not using it, of course, to discriminate against anybody, but you're just kind of using it to be helpful in helping you evaluate, are you reaching a particular goal? And I think if you're upfront with people and let them know that you're asking certain information because you want to achieve, so because you want to be inclusive and representative, not because you're trying to check any sort of diversity box. You really do care about making sure that people feel like they belong, and that the environment that you're creating is reflective of the people in which you want to serve. And the best way to do that is to have some numbers to help you track that, how you're doing, so that you're not making these assumptions about people. Because assumptions are supposed to be wrong.
And people can, like, one of the things that a lot of people say about co-working spaces is when you walk in and you're working, you can feel what's going on in there.
Yes.
You know, you can have the most amazing furniture, but if the, like, human interaction vibe is missing, you know, it just feels, ugh. The other thing I'm dying to pick your brains about is events, and can you say a bit about Manals? Because one of the issues, you know, I'm always getting into trouble with event organizers about my manaling. So can you say, talk a bit about the Shine Bootcamp and why diversity and inclusion is really important there. And we'll link to your two things we'll link to before you launch into it is your Instagram, because there's good stuff on there. And also, I really enjoyed the podcast you did with Amy Porterfield that had I mean, maybe it's not as good as this one, but you know, I'm sure it's worth people listening to. So what about events? Because that's huge.
Yes. Okay. So let's just be very clear. In 2020, there's absolutely no reason why there should ever be a MANL ever again. Unless maybe it is on a topic for men, right? Or a conference that's specifically for men. But if you are trying to attract women, there should be no reason for a MANL. I think that we're in an industry, there's industries across the board where there are very capable speakers, and we've got to break the habit of just going to the people who might be in our immediate network or the people who are on the stages across the board. If you find that you are a conference organizer and you're having trouble finding women or, you know, BIPOC people to be on your stage, that means that you just have to start to expand your search. But you have to be very clear about the diversity that you want on your stage. And then that will actually help you on the back end to attract a more diverse audience. I read an article a couple of years ago about HubSpot and their inbound conference. And they made it a very clear priority that they wanted to have a very diverse slate of speakers on the stage. So they did. They had to go through some of their untraditional channels to find people, just because that, you know, they had to go beyond their existing channels. It wasn't that people didn't exist. It just wasn't, they were able to find them in different avenues. And as a result, they found that their audience members were much more diverse as well. Speaking about closing a leaky bucket, they started to attract people that they weren't before just by changing who they had on the stage. And it wasn't that they were pushing people away. The people who were always coming continued to come. If you find that you are having some trouble finding women speakers in a particular industry or people of color in a particular industry, that doesn't let you off the hook. There are programs that are in place to groom speakers who are underrepresented. So for instance, Shine Bootcamp you mentioned, it's actually happening right now. I am training a group of women right now. We had our first kickoff last night. Basically, its whole purpose is to train a group of women speakers to be ready to take the stage. And Google has done this, and PRX and Spotify have done this in particular to attract more women and people of color into the world of podcasting by creating different sorts of training programs to, one, bring more people in, but also to get them ready to really just excel, so that the answer can never be, oh, we can't find, you know, qualified people. If that is the case, you can work to create an environment to where you're preparing and grooming people to take that stage as well.
It is one of those Spotify people is Sangeeta, who I mentioned, who mm-hmm. runs a podcast called The Masala Monologues. Mm-hmm. And she used to come to me for podcast advice, but she never talks to me anymore. She's now she's in season two of Spotify.
Wow.
And sometimes if we have a coffee, she sends a car to pick me up. But because one of the things, it's not every event, but you know, quite a lot of events have been like, oh, you know, I said, how come we've got, you know, one event I worked on, I said, you know, we have got, you know, you do realize we have 80% of the people on this speaker lineup are male, mm-hmm. and there's one black guy. And it's like, yeah, I know, it's terrible, isn't it? And I said, well, you know, we need to try harder. And the person organizing the event, and they weren't being nasty. They were like really lovely. They said, oh, but women, you know, the women just don't get back to me. And, you know, like what? I kind of think, I know what you're going to say, but like, what would you say to that?
Goes back to what you said, try harder. And also going back to what we were saying before is building relationships with people. Whenever you have a relationship with people, they get back to you. And I bet the men that they had reached out to, they had some type of relationship that made it easy for them, you know, it made it easy for them to say yes, because whenever my friend calls or somebody who I know and I'm connected to, and we've got some type of relationship, you return the call.
Brilliant. I didn't even see that coming. That's so obvious. Is there anything else you'd like to add before we come to a close here?
Just recognize recognize that this whole thing of being more inclusive and creating a customer experience that makes people feel like they belong, it's a process. It's something that no matter where you are, you can move the needle to get better. It's all about continuous improvement, but it won't happen until you start. So just start, educate yourself, know that it's okay. You'll make some mistakes along the way, but keep going. Find people to help you as you're going along, but don't get stuck and don't feel like, even if you've had missteps in the past, that you can't move it forward. You can.
That's brilliant. We're gonna put links in the show notes, but is there anywhere you'd like to people to hunt you down online and follow you?
Feel free to reach out on my website is soniaethompson.com, and you can get connected to me there and all the places where I show up online.
Brilliant. Really appreciate your time today. Thank you very much for all that wisdom and belonging.
Thanks so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you very much for your time today. As a co-working space owner or manager, you may never know where to start with your marketing, even if you know exactly what needs to be done. Are you always stopping and starting communication for your co-working space? Get distracted by shiny things and new fads? Do you blog once a year and not even know why you're blogging? If you're like me, you've read hundreds of books on business and marketing, but still get stuck in action. How often have you done the same thing 12 weeks in a row? Head to berniejmitchell.com and hit the green book a call button to spend a few hours with me to nail a simple 90-day marketing plan you will actually execute on. We'll work out a 12-week plan of content, emails, and other actions to build your sales funnel. I'm 100% confident I can help you. So confident, in fact, I'll give you your money back right on the spot at the end of our call if you don't find our time together useful. In the last decade, I've helped hundreds of people get clear on where to go next, what tools to use, and how to stay consistent with their marketing. Head to berniejmitchell.com and book a call today.